For Kenyan societies, we've seen a lot of interesting interactions between what's happening on social media, what social media has made possible, especially with regards to how people are defining communities and how people are defining belonging and being part of this Kenyan nation. You have to keep in mind that Kenya has a history of authoritarianism. We lived under a one-party regime for almost 40 years. And there was a lot of control over what people could say, where people could say it, when people could gather. There was not really freedom of association, there was not really freedom of expression, there was not really freedom of speech. We're seeing people uniting across ethnic groups, across gender lines, across age lines, to come together to help people find work, for example, whether you're talking about hashtags like IkoKaziKE. We're seeing people coming together to raise money for victims of domestic violence in very remote parts of the country that wouldn't otherwise be heard from in terms of like the main cities in the country. It's really enabled people to tell a new story about Kenyan identity and Kenyan belonging, which has become a very powerful political force. The negative effects have been severe in some cases. One element that we've seen, for example, is the propagation of hate speech. Now, this is really important because Kenyan elections can be very competitive, and they can usually be contested along ethnic lines. And it's a very easy point of mobilization for a politician who has enough money to spend on this thing. Whether you're talking about instigating physical violence by paying people to go and attack people in another part of the city, another part of the town, or whether you're talking about people paying trolls and you know, creating bots online in order to spread specific hate messages. We saw a great upswing in online hate speech over the 2017 election. Another concern for me is what I call digital colonialism, which is international corporations, foreign corporations, that are coming into and using social media as an entry point to enter the political conversation, to manipulate public opinion in favor of a specific candidate, in favor of a specific political party. And we've seen, number one, the government in Kenya spending absurd amounts of money on British corporations that are able to do this, the data scraping and the analytics operations. In the last election, both the ruling party and the main opposition spent a significant amount of money on these things. And we're wondering, shouldn't this money be spent domestically, for example, on social welfare projects? And what does it mean for a British corporation to come and interfere in a Kenyan election for profit, and profits that will be extradited to the UK and not necessarily remain in the Kenyan political space? These are some of the challenges that I think social media has presented with regards to the political process in Kenya. I feel like the most important thing that we can do right now as a global community is to spend more time bringing the human back into the digital conversation and seeing human behavior through the lens of whether it's psychology or sociology or history or anthropology, to bring that humanities lens back into how we understand human behavior. Because I think for too long we've assumed that technology was a neutral thing, and that if we just threw enough technology at some of these complex human problems, that they would be solved faster or more efficiently. And the case of Kenya is telling us that it's just simply not that true. Yes, there's been some fantastic developments and some really good things, but there are also a lot of things that are cause for concern. The way in which the digital is intersecting with the analog is raising a lot of challenges that require much more of a nuanced and much more of a sophisticated approach than simply just keep throwing technology at the problem. We can't keep abandoning this space to techies. We can't keep abandoning this space to just, you know, technical regulation and technical sort of tweaking of the systems. What we really need to understand is that some of these platforms are changing how we relate to our communities, how we relate to our families, how we relate to our nation state. These are fundamentally humanities-oriented questions, and we need more of that conversation to just kind of address what's happening in those spaces. It's worth remembering that at this particular point, we are on the third iteration of social networking platforms. So there's no guarantee that what we're seeing right now, the Facebook and the Twitters, which are about 12, 14, 15 years from now, there's no guarantee that they will 5 years from now that they will social networking platforms will exist the way they exist today. Something new might come up, something new might displace, and there's a really good chance that it will displace what's popular today. And so from a human, from a political perspective, from a regulatory perspective, then I ask myself, are we regulating for the platforms that we have now? Or are we working towards creating a climate whereby any network that comes up, wherever it comes up, will be able to respond to some of these challenges in a much more humane way? Are we creating a climate that will give us the kind of social networking sites that we will need to have peaceful, just, inclusive societies instead of only focusing on addressing the issues that are embedded on the platforms that exist today?